WQNA, 88.3 The Edge. Yes, indeedy. Okay, since I haven't played an album of the week for since the first show of the year, I've decided I'm going to do two albums of the week this week. First of all, today in history, come here, notes. It is the birthday of Johannes Christomos Wolfgangus Theophilus Amadeus Mozart, born January 27th, 1756. In Salzburg, the Holy Roman Empire, also known as Austria. And that's about all I've got about that. I've got a few ideas for a way to satirize Mozart's birthday, but they didn't come together in time. So in another 6 years, I'll be able to pull the gag off, hopefully. All right. Also, on January 30th, 1968, definitely one of the greatest albums of all time, one of the most deeply influential albums of all time was released. The Velvet Underground released their second album, White Light, White Heat, and I've got an almost all covers version of it that I'm going to start off the night with tonight. We're going to be starting off with a track off of an album that came out in 2012, that movie Lawless, the one with Tom Hardy and Jessica Chastain, a couple other folks, you know, about the bootleggers. It's one of the oddest soundtracks, God knows why, but it's got Emmylou Harris and Ralph Stanley and Nick Cave and Warren Ellis, and it has Mr. Mark Lanegan doing the lead-off track, the title track from White Light, White Heat. So let's just let it roll here, shall we? Here you go.
One, two, three.
White light.
While I go and messing up my mind.
The white light.
Don't you know it's gonna make me go blind.
White heat.
Oh, white heat, it tickled me down to my toes.
White light.
Lord have mercy, white light, goodness knows.
White light.
While I go and messing up my brain.
White light.
Oh, white light, it's gonna drive me insane.
White heat.
Oh, white light, it tickled me down to my toes.
White light.
Oh, white light, I said now.
Earl Jeffers had reached his limit. It was now mid-August, which meant he'd been separated from Marcia for more than 2 months. 2 months and all he had to show were three dogged letters and two very expensive long-distance phone calls. Two when school had ended and she'd returned to Wisconsin and he to Locust, Pennsylvania. She had sworn to maintain a certain fidelity. She would date occasionally, but merely as amusement. She would remain faithful. But lately, Waldo had begun to worry. He had trouble sleeping at night. When he did, he had horrible dreams. He lay awake at night, tossing and turning underneath his pleated quilt protector. Tears welling in his eyes as he pictured Marcia, her sworn vows of a come-by liquor and the smooth soothing of some Neanderthal, finally submitting to the caresses of sexual oblivion. It was more than the human mind could bear. Visions of Marcia's faithlessness haunted him. Daytime fantasies of sexual abandon permeated his thoughts. And the thing was, they wouldn't understand how she really was. He, Waldo, alone understood this. He had intuitively grasped every nook and cranny of her psyche. He had made her smile. She needed him, and he wasn't there. Ah. The idea came to him on the Thursday before the Mama's Parade. He just finished mowing and edging the Edison's lawn for $1.50. And then checked the mailbox to see if there's at least a word from Marcia. There was nothing but a circular from the Amalgamated Aluminum Company of America inquiring into his awning needs. At least they cared enough to write. It was a New York company. You could go anywhere in the mails. And then it struck him. He didn't have enough money to go to Wisconsin in the accepted fashion, true. But why not mail himself? It was absurdly simple. He would ship himself parcel post special delivery. And the next day, Waldo went to the supermarket to purchase the necessary equipment. He bought masking tape, a staple gun, and a medium-sized cardboard box just right for the person his bill. He judged that with a minimum of jostling, he could ride quite comfortably. A few air holes, some water, perhaps some midnight snacks, and it would probably be as good as going tourist. So by Friday afternoon, Waldo was set. He was thoroughly packed, and the post office had agreed to pick him up at 3 o'clock. He had marked the package fragile, and as he curled up inside, resting in the foam rubber cushioning he thoughtfully included, he tried to picture the look of awe and happiness on Marcia's face. As she opened her door, saw the package, tipped the deliverer, and then opened it to see her Waldo finally there in person. She would kiss him, and then maybe they could see a movie. If he'd only thought of this before. Suddenly, rough hands gripped his package, and he found himself borne up, landing with a thud in a truck that was off. Marcia Bronson had just finished setting her hair. It had been a very rough weekend. She had to remember not to drink like that. Bill had been nice about it, though. After it was over, he said he still respected her. And after all, it was certainly the way of nature. And even though, no, he did not love her, he did feel an affection for her. And after all, they were grown adults. Oh, and Bill could teach Waldo. But that seemed many years ago. Sheila Klein, her very, very best friend, walked in through the porch screen door and into the kitchen. Oh, God, it's absolutely maudlin outside, she said. I know what you mean. I feel all licky. And Marcia tightened the belt on her cotton robe. Sheila ran her finger over some salt grains on the kitchen table, licked her fingers and made a face. I'm supposed to be taking these salt pills, she said, but they make me feel like throwing up. Marcia started to pat herself under the chin, an exercise she'd seen on television. God, don't even talk about that, she said. Got up from the table and went to the sink, where she picked up a bottle of pink and blue vitamins. One plunge isn't supposed to be better than steak, and then attempted to touch her knees. I don't think I'll ever touch a daiquiri again. She gave up and sat down, this time near the small table that held the telephone. Maybe Bill will call, she said, to Sheila's glance. Sheila nibbled her cuticle. After last night, I thought maybe he'd be through with him. I know what you mean. My God, he's like an octopus. Hands all over the place. She gestured, raising her arms up while in defense. The thing is, after a while, you get tired of fighting with him, you know. And after all, I didn't really do anything Friday and Saturday, so I kind of owed it to him, you know what I mean? She started to scratch. Sheila was giggling with her hand over her mouth. I tell you, I felt the same way, and even after a while, here she bent forward in a whisper. I wanted to. And now she was laughing very loudly. It was at this point that Mr. Jameson of the Clarence Darrow Post Office rang the doorbell of the large stucco-covered frame house. When Marsha Bronson opened the door, he helped her carry the package in, had his yellow and green slip signed, and left with a tip that Marsha had gotten out of her mother's small beige pocketbook in the den. What do you think it is? She asked. Marsha stood with her arms folded behind her back. She stared at the brown carbon carton and sat in the middle of the living room. I don't know, she said. Inside the package, Waldo quivered with excitement as he listened to the muffled voices. Sheila ran her fingernail over the masking tape that ran down the center of the carton. Why don't you look at the return address and see who it's from? Waldo felt his heart beating. He could feel the vibrating footsteps. It would be soon. Marsha walked around the carton and read the ink-scratched label. Oh, God, it's from Waldo. That schmuck, said Sheila. Waldo trembled with expectation. Well, you might as well open it, said Sheila. Both of them tried to lift the staple flap. Whoa, said Marsha, groaning. He must have nailed it shut. They tugged on the flap again. My God, you need a power drill to get this thing open. They pulled again. You can't get a grip, and they both stood still, breathing heavily. Why don't you get a scissors, said Sheila. And Marsha ran into the kitchen, but all she could find was a little sewing scissor. Then she remembered that her father kept a collection of tools in the basement. She ran downstairs, and when she came back up, she had a large sheet metal cutter in her hand. This is the best I could find. She was very out of breath. Here, you do it. I think I'm gonna die. And she sank into the fluffy couch and exhaled noisily. Sheila tried to make a slit between the masking tape and the end of the cardboard flap, but the blade was too big and there wasn't enough room. God damn this thing, she said, feeling exasperated. Then smiling, she said, I've got an idea. What, said Marsha. Just watch, said Sheila, touching a finger to her hand. Inside the package, Waldo was so transfixed with excitement he could barely breathe. His skin felt prickly from the heat, and he could feel his heart beating in his throat. It would be soon. Sheila stood quite upright and walked round to the other side of the package. Then she sank down to her knees, grasped the cutter by both handles, took a deep breath, and plunged the long blade through the middle of the package, through the masking tape, through the cardboard, through the cushioning, and right through the center of Waldo Jeffers' head, which split slightly and caused little rhythmic arcs of red to pulsate gently in the morning sun.
gentlemen.
The human race.
Shiver comes down now. Shiver comes down now.